Hi class, today we're going to take a look at how you solve rational equations. And when you solve rational equations, you're going to deal with them in a very similar manner to the way you dealt with fractions in just regular equations that we've done in the past. For instance, let's say we had 2/3 x minus 4/5 fifths equals 1/3. For this particular problem, since it had a lot of fractions in it, we could deal with this by clearing our fractions out, and we did that by multiplying by the least common denominator. And for this particular problem, since all of these are just regular fractions with numbers, we can look at all the denominators all the way across this entire equation, the 3, the 5, and the 3, and determine that our least common denominator is 15. So once we determine that our LCD, or least common denominator, is 15, we were able to eliminate our fractions in this particular equation by multiplying the entire equation by that 15. And when we did that, we could take and distribute the 15 and do 15 times 2/3 x minus 15 times our 4/5, and that would equal 15 times 1/3. And when you did that, you could remember that these 15s were all over 1. And when you multiply fractions, you cross-cancel. So if we took a look at our first section right here, this 3 could cross-cancel with a 15. And we'd say 3 goes into 3 once and 15 5 times. And then the only thing in the denominator here is 1, so we would no longer need the denominator, and you could just do 5 times 2 times x, which is 10x. And notice that our fraction has disappeared. If you move on to the next one, this 5 here could cross-cancel with a 15, and we would say 5 goes into 5 once and 15 3 times. And again, the denominators are 1, so we don't need to write them, and we can just do 3 times 4 is 12. And then in the last one here, the 3 here could cancel with the 15 because 3 goes into 3 once and 15 5 times. Again, we only have 1 in the denominator, so 5 times 1 in the numerator gives us 5. And what we're left with is a much, much easier equation to solve because there aren't any fractions. This process we just did right here is exactly the same thing that we're going to do with our rational equations. It just might be a little bit harder for us to actually see what the common denominator is. So we'll take a look at those in a minute. Let's first go ahead and finish this problem. The next thing we would do is move our 12 over, and since it's a negative 12 because it's minus 12, we'll add a positive 12 to both sides. These would cancel, and we're left with 10x equals 17. And now we can go ahead and divide both sides by 10, and our solution is that x is going to end up being 17 over 10. So we would say, and you could say this in a sentence if you wanted, the solution is 17/10, because that's the value you would plug in for x, and this would work. So now, since this process is exactly the same as what we're going to do for a rational equation, let's take a look at one of those. The rational equations might look something like this particular problem here. We might have something like x over x minus 2 minus 1 over x plus 5 equals 7 over x squared plus 3x minus 10. Now, this problem right away, you're going, wow, how do we find our least common denominator? Well, the first thing we need to do is notice that this first denominator here is already factored. So we need to treat it as it is an x minus 2. And this second denominator here is an x plus 5, which is already factored also, so it is an x plus 5. So our least common denominator has to include an x minus 2 and an x plus 5. But if we look at this last denominator here, this one's not factored, so we can't really tell what it is until we factor it. So let's go ahead and take a look. We have three terms here. The leading coefficient here is 1. So we look at the factors of negative 10 that add up to 3. And I notice that 5 times negative 2 is 10, and 5 plus negative 2 is 3. So since 5 times negative 2 is 10, and 5 plus negative 2 is 3, this will factor into x plus 5 times x minus 2. And now I can see that this last fraction here has both factors that are in these first two. So our least common denominator, or our LCD, for this entire equation is x minus 2 times x plus 5. Now, before we go ahead and multiply this, what we want to do is take a look at the fact that we have a subtraction right here. And I don't want to make a mistake with positive and negatives. So the first thing I'm going to do is distribute that subtraction and make this plus and a negative 1 there. Then I can take a look at my entire equation and multiply the whole thing by that LCD. And since I have room on the right-hand side, I'm going to go ahead and put my multiplication over here. It doesn't matter which side you have it on. So I'm going to distribute this and multiply it by my first expression over here, which gives me x minus 2 times x plus 5 times x over x minus 2. It's very important to write this first step completely out. I find that people who skip this step I'm doing right now have a lot of errors in their problems. So now we'll distribute it to the next one. And finally distribute it to the last one here. And when I distribute it to this last one here, I'm going to put my plus 5 first, it doesn't matter what order they're in. Make sure that you leave the denominator in factored form. That will make it easier for you to see what cancels when we go back. So now let's start with this first one here. This is all over 1. So when you write it that way, you can see that these cancel out. And what we're left with is just an x plus 5 times my x. And then on this next one, if you write this over 1, you can see that these x plus 5s cancel. And all we're left with is the x minus 2 times a negative 1. And then over on this other side here, when you write this over 1, you can see this cancels, and so does this. And the only thing left over there is the 7. So now all of our fractions have disappeared. So we need to simplify and solve this. So I'm going to distribute my x to get x squared plus 5x plus negative 1 times that's going to be negative x. Negative 1 times that will be plus 2. And then I need to move my 7 over. And the reason why I need to do that is because I notice that there is an x squared here. If you have an x squared in what's left, then you need to get 0 on one side and factor in order to solve the problem. If you don't have an x squared and the highest exponent is 1, you can just solve the problem regularly. But we have an x squared here. So I'm going to need to get 0 on one side. So let's go ahead and subtract 7 from both sides, which will give me a 0 over here. And on the other side, if I combine my like terms, I'll get x squared plus 4x minus 5. Now I can factor and solve. And I notice there's 3 terms. 1, 2, 3. And the leading coefficient is 1. So I need to look at the negative 5, what multiplies to get negative 5 and adds up to a positive 4. And I notice 5 and negative 1 do that. So this will be x plus 5 times x minus 1. Now, to solve, I set each factor equal to 0. So I'm going to go into these two equations over here, x plus 5 equals 0. The other equation will be x minus 1 equals 0. On the first one, if I subtract 5 from both sides, I get x equals negative 5. And on the second one, if I add 1 to both sides, I get x equals 1. So these would be the two possible solutions. And you might be saying, whew, that was a lot of work, we're done. However, one thing you always have to do on these is check your solutions, because there's something we call an extraneous solution. Sometimes you solve these and everything you do is correct. However, the solution that you get is something that will make the denominator 0. We now have variables in the denominator, and you can't have a 0 in the denominator. So if we go back and look at this original equation, notice the denominator here would be 0 if x was 2, and here it would be 0 if x is negative 5. And over here, if we had either negative 5 or 2, we would get a 0 in the denominator there. So it looks like the restrictions on this equation, we call them restrictions because they're values that x cannot be, the restrictions would be 2 and negative 5, because that's what would make these denominators 0, or a possibility of a 0. Notice that in our solutions here, one of the solutions was negative 5, and that will make this denominator and this denominator 0, which we can't have. So what we do is, if we get an extraneous solution, we just cross it out, and the only solution that we would use for this is 1. 1 is the only thing that we will be able to plug in and have it work and not have any zeros in the denominator. So always make sure you double check your solutions to see if you have an extraneous solution when you get your final solution. Now,